welcome you to our worship service this morning. It is the mid of August. It's a little better weather than it was last Sunday, right? So I am glad you are here. So let me explain what we're doing this month. I'm doing a sermon series on the spiritual lives of classical composers. So last week we heard about Bach. This week we're gonna hear about Handel. He is really a German, right? He was what I did, a transplant from Germany to England. I came to the United States, but he followed his lord, his employer, basically, who became king of England. So he followed him. But I'll tell you a little bit about his life and his spiritual life in the sermon. I want to, again, welcome you, and please know that whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here at the First Congregational Church of Sharon, Massachusetts. But for now, friends, let us join together in our call to worship. Show us your ways, O Lord. Lead us in your truth. And teach us. Open our eyes, minds, and hearts to know your will and to follow it. Reveal your vision for us and keep us focused and faithful to what you would have us do. Our opening song, Morning Has Broken.
First morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. The rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new. First morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Thank you.
Will you please join me in our opening prayer? Lord, we have not trusted you in all our scurrying to prepare, even spiritually. You have forgotten this one thing, to believe, to cling, to lay our burdens on you. We have failed to trust in your eternal realm. We brought it all on ourselves to carry the weight of sin, the need to fix our own problems and clean up our own messes. In all this striving, we miss the brightness of your morning star. We miss the fullness of the joy a life lived in you radiates. Fill us with your truth. Shape us into creatures who trust and obey, that we may rejoice with you in our salvation. Gather us into your love and hear us as we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture for this morning comes from the book of Job, chapter 19, verses 23 through 26. Oh, that my words were written down. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. Oh, that with an iron pen and with lead they were engraved on a rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, then my flesh, then in my flesh I shall see God. Here ends this morning's scripture reading. And may God bless the hearing and understanding of God's holy word. Now we know that the life of Job is proof that humankind usually has no idea what God is doing behind the scenes in the life of each believer. All humans ask the question, why do bad things happen to good people? This is an age-old question, and one that is sometimes difficult to answer in human terms, if it actually is indeed able to be answered. Because we know that God is always present and in control, and no matter what happens, there are no coincidences. Nothing happens by chance. Job was a man of faith. He knew that God was in charge, though he had no way of knowing why so many terrible tragedies were occurring in his life. Job never lost his faith in God, even under the most heartbreaking circumstances that tested him to the core. It's hard to imagine losing everything we own in one day. Our property, our possessions, even our children. That is what happened to Job. And on top of this, his health is failing him too. I don't know about you, but I think most people would really sink into depression and even become suicidal after such a nightmare. However, although Job must have felt all of those emotions, he never wavered in his understanding that God is still in control. Job's three friends, on the other hand, instead of comforting him, gave him bad advice and even accused him of committing sins so grievous that God was punishing him by making his life miserable. Job, though, knew God well enough to know that God did not work in that way. In fact, he had such an intimate personal relationship with God that he was able to make this very statement, "I know that my Redeemer lives, and at last he will take his stand on the earth. Even after my skin is destroyed, yet from my flesh will I see God." That kind of spiritual resilience is amazing and, quite frankly, admirable. Today, I'm going to share with you some insights about the life of George Frederick Handel, or as I know him, as Georg Friedrich Handel. Although he is probably next to Bach the most important composer of the Baroque era, his life and his path took a very different direction. As much as Bach had to live through his own trials and tribulations, fired by Leipzig town politics and personal losses, they fade in light of what Handel went through. If he would not have had the kind of resilience similar to Job's, spiritually and physically, the story of Handel's life would almost be not worthwhile to share with the world. By 1741, Handel was a failure, bankrupt, in great physical pain, and the victim of plots to sabotage his career. The once great opera composer scheduled a farewell appearance in London that very April. To the London elite, it looked like that this German nincompoop, which really means fool, as he was once called, was through. But all that would change unexpectedly. But I'm getting ahead of myself. And I can't even show you my beautiful PowerPoint presentation. This is driving me really mad today. Why this is not working. Oh well. I'm not going to fool with this. Oh, look, there he is. He came back. Oh, there's hope. All right, picture two. What happened? Okay. George Frederick was born in Halle in 1684, a contemporary of Bach, who was born in 1865, a fellow German and a Lutheran. Handel did not have the musical family to back him up. Although his father noticed his musical talent, he did everything to discourage it. His son was to become a lawyer. Only after the Duke heard him play as an eight-year-old, he ordered his father to provide him with a formal musical education. And grudgingly, he did. And by the age of 12, Handel had written his first composition and substituted for his organ teacher. Handel indeed studied law for a few months before he turned to his musical career full time. His musical education took place in Germany and Italy. And in Italy, he met and studied under Dominic Scarlatti. Handel was the sort of individual who stood out in a crowd, large boned and loud. He often wore an enormous white wig with curls cascading down his shoulders. When he spoke, his English was replete with colorful snatches of German, French, and Italian. His music, I think, also reflects his largeness. Lots of instruments, trumpet, drums, the more the merrier. He sought employment at music-loving courts all over Europe, composed works and around themes that were fashionable of the time. Eventually, as I said, he moved to England for good because he followed the Elector of Hanover, his employer, who would be King George I of England in 1714. That's the Elector. And this is the house where he lived for all his time in England, actually. That's an inside view. Handel wrote his greatest music in England, but he also suffered great personal setbacks, as well due to falling in and out of favor with changing monarchs, competing with established English composers, dealing with fickle, hard-to-please audiences, and constantly being attacked by the church for using biblical themes and scriptures to be performed in public houses and secular theaters. His greatest passion was the opera. An ill-timed passion for the form was quickly falling out of fashion in England. He pretty much funded every performance out of his own pocket, which eventually would lead him to bankruptcy, not just once, but twice. Yet to his credit, Handel retained a sense of humor through virtually any hardship. Once, just as an oratorio was about to begin, several of his friends gathered to console him over the extremely sparse audience that had come to the performance. "Never mind," Handel joked to his friends, "the music will sound better due to the acoustics of the nearly empty hall." So in 1741, at the age of 56, he was ready to quit the music business. He was swimming in debt, certain that he would end up in debtor's prison. He gave what he considered his farewell concert on April 8th. It was around that time two unforeseen events converged to change his life. A wealthy friend, Charles Jensen, gave Handel a libretto based on the life of Christ, taken entirely from the Bible. And he also received a commission from a Dublin charity to compose music for a benefit performance. The money raised would be used to help free men from debtor's prison, and Handel would receive a generous commission. So, with the text in hand and the motivation to stay out of prison, he began composing The Messiah on August 22, 1741. It was finished in 24 days and 260 pages thick, an immense physical and creative feat. When he finished writing what would have been known as the Hallelujah Chorus, he said, "I did think I did see all heaven before me and the great God himself." The premiere of The Messiah was a sensation, although once again criticized by the church. But to handle it didn't really matter. The first performance raised over 400 pounds, releasing 142 men from debtor's prison. Until his death, Handel conducted 30 performances of the Messiah, but only one of them in a church at Bristol Cathedral. In that audience, though, said John Wesley, his remarks were, I doubt if that congregation was ever so serious at a sermon as they were during this performance. The Messiah helped turn things around for Handel. His hard-won popularity remained constant until his death. By the end of his life, Messiah was firmly established in the standard repertoire, and its influence on other composers would be extraordinary. But his masterpiece did so much more. Most of its performances were benefit concerts for the Foundling Hospital, of which Handel was a major benefactor. One biographer noted, "Messiah has fed the hungry, clothed the naked, fostered the orphan, more than any other musical production." Another wrote, "Perhaps the works of no other composer have so largely contributed to the relief of human suffering." And with great likelihood, Messiah has done more to convince thousands that there is a God about us than all the theological works ever written. The religious beliefs of the composer who created the world's most popular religious masterpiece, though, is somewhat of a puzzle. In an era when Christian musicians typically worked for local churches, Handel, composer of secular opera, chamber, and orchestral music, did not fit that pattern. Yet many of his operas find inspiration within Holy Scriptures. Handel was a devout follower of Christ and widely known for his concern for others who suffered. He donated freely to charities, even in times when he faced personal financial ruin. He was a relentless optimist whose faith in God sustained him through every difficult moment in life. Raised a sincere Lutheran, he harbored no sectarian animosities and steered clear of denominational disagreements. This is my favorite. Once defending himself before a quarrelsome archbishop, Handel simply said, "I have read my Bible very well, and I will choose for myself." A few days before Handel died, he expressed the desire to die on Good Friday, in hopes of meeting this good God, his sweet Lord and Savior, on the day of his resurrection. He lived until the morning of Good Saturday, April 14th, 1759. His close friend James Smith wrote, "He died as he lived, a good Christian with a true sense of his duty to God and to man, and in perfect charity with all the world." Handel was buried in Westminster Abbey with over 3,000 people in attendance at his funeral. The statue erected there shows him holding the manuscript for the solo that opens the third part of the Messiah, "I know that my Redeemer liveth." Job-like resilience. I think that if Handel had not possessed an amazing ability to bounce back from repeated disaster, such well-loved works as the Messiah and the royal fireworks music and the water music would never have been written. How often must he have felt like giving up, seeing his talent go unappreciated, while other composers with less talent enjoying the success that had eluded him for so many years. How exasperated that must have been. But Handel refused to be deterred by setbacks, attacks, illness, and even severe financial woes. It is a tribute to the faith and optimism Handel possessed, relying on God as he worked to overcome these significant obstacles and to create music that is universally cherished today. So, how resilient is your faith? Is it strong at all times, in all circumstances? Or does it depend on the situation or the mood you are in? Would you make it through what Job experienced or Handel, and still be able to joyfully sing, "I know that my Redeemer lives. I know God loves me and stands next to me every step of the way"? Some say faith cannot be taught or learned. You either have it or you don't. Sure, we can read the Bible and go to church faithfully. We can listen to other people who are living examples of a living faith to see how they do it. But will that help us be more spiritually resilient? The German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer testified in his prison poem, "Who Am I?", that faith is the miracle of God-given trust, that willingness beyond willfulness that crawls into the lap of a trustworthy God, encouraging one to conclude in the face of all of life's questions and circumstances that indeed our Redeemer lives. Amen. Prayers for the days. I have two prayer concerns. I want us to keep in our thoughts and prayers Mary Peltier, who is dealing with pneumonia, and Allison Pfeiffer, who has made it to Florida to visit her dad. They kept him in the hospital. She's hoping to put him in a good rehab facility for a week or two. And then she's getting ready his house, a fridge stuffed with food and freezer to have him return to his home with a little bit more care. But things are looking actually pretty good. So prayers, continued prayers for Leo. Is there anyone else on your hearts? Then friends, let us pray. We call on you with thanksgiving, Lord of heaven and earth, and we come before you with all our hearts. We set you apart as the one deserving all our praise, and we call on your love and faithfulness for the sake of your name. We call to you trusting that you will answer. We call for all who are sick, suffering, or struggling. And we pray, O Lord, increase the strength of those who are weak. We pray for those who govern nations and hold power in this world. We ask that you speak your words of wisdom and justice, and let there be ears to hear. We pray for those whose gifts of beauty and skill give glory to your name and joy to others. Guard them in your mercy. Lord Most High, we pray for those who are weighed down by injustice, by violence, or fear. Lift up the lowly and bring forth your justice. O Lord, we pray for all those who have gone through natural disasters in these past weeks as the war in Ukraine continues on. As people worry about their life and livelihoods, as life is getting more and more expensive, there are so many things around us in our world, in our hearts, that need your help and your love and your blessing. So God, we pray that you are the one who increases the strength who gives them resilience, who loves them like no one else can love. And Holy One, we call on you for ourselves. In the midst of whatever trouble we may find ourselves in, walk along us and guide us in your service. O Lord, make good the purpose for which you have called us, to love, to serve, and to be a blessing to this world. We trust, O God, in your enduring love made real for us in Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. That your Redeemer lives. And whatever we go through, whatever this journey of life and faith has to offer to us, may we be able to say the same as Job did, as Handel did, and as so many faithful people said before us, yes, our Redeemer lives indeed. May we step out into the world with a faith that has the strength to see God in all circumstances. And as we do so, may the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit go with us all. Amen. And I cannot let you go without playing you the Hallelujah Chorus.